Hello, Steve.
Hey, how are you doing, Dr. G?
Good. How are you doing? Good to see you.
Thank you. Good to see you too. I heard a lot about you.
Oh, thank you.
Well, I didn't say it was good. I just said I heard a lot about you.
That's okay. Bad news is also some news, you know?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. There's no such thing when you're trying to be famous. No, all of it's been good. And, you know, it's kind of it's a who's who of people that you work with. And I know you obviously know that, but I thought I'd go right to the source and see if we can get some ideas. You know, I'm working with Ron Aiken. You know him right well. So
yeah,
he's shown me his 18-week plans and his yearly, multi-year plans. And he's actually working with me because I wrote a software program called Cool Coach way back in the day.
Yes.
It was way ahead of everybody at the time. Now it's, you know, there's so much more technology, but we wrote it in Excel, but it did some things that, you know, we're still, I think they're still mostly ahead of their time. I just got an email this morning from a coach around here that, you know, the workout, it shows EN1, but there's no velocity of the swimmer. So, you know, unless that interval was exactly right, he probably needs to learn something as the rest of us do. And again, we'd rather learn from you. So if you wouldn't mind, could you, and I don't know you well at all, so could you start with, you know, where you started and where you came from and your education and experience?
Yeah, sure. So I grew up in Lithuania, small country in East Europe,
sure.
And did my undergrad, postgrad studies as well, a PhD in Lithuania, actually a PhD I did in Russia already. When I was in Russia, I started to develop a quantifying training adaptation. That was back in the 80s, a long time ago, and did my PhD over there. And since then, we started to develop computer software. In fact, first computer software we developed was in 1985, when I was still a PhD student, designing training based on rate of adaptation. Okay, and I did a lot of presentation when I was, with the US Assuming, ASCA, and other organizations, FINA, on these topics, there is a FINA learning platform you probably know on FINA website. So it's free access. You can look at my presentations over there, including this training design based on rate of adaptation. Okay, what that means. So idea is that we need to measure adaptation and design training accordingly. Because if you are, let's say, aerobic adaptation improves in 1 week, 6%, let's say, okay, anaerobic 3%. Sprint adaptation improves 2%. What you should do next week? Ideally, you should probably increase your volumes in these energy zones accordingly, according to your adaptation. Then you will be perfect match with what training you need to do and perfect match to your adaptation with the training volumes in different energy systems. Same on land as well. If you improve, let's say, land adaptation improves 10% per week, you probably need next week, you can handle 10% higher volumes in this energy zone, correct? Yeah. So, ideas have been around already for decades in East Europe. And we did a lot of studies, not only in swimming, but many other sports as well. And once we started studies, we learned that there is a different rates of adaptation. Some athletes adapting faster than others, okay? Younger athletes adapting faster than older ones, and sometimes much faster, even several times faster adaptation for young athletes than older ones during the season. Say girls adapting slower than boys at the same age, because girls are biologically older a little bit. The younger you biologically, the faster adaptation happens, okay? So then next thing we learned that sprinters, middle distance swimmers adapt differently. And normally sprinters tend to adapt better to anaerobic training than middle distance or distance swimmers.
Mm-hmm.
Then we learned that aerobic adaptation, even for sprinters, going faster than sprint adaptation, okay? So all this should be taken into account designing training season. Okay, and since now we know pretty well rates of adaptation, depending on age, gender, event, depending on energy system, different volumes, training volumes components, so we can design training accordingly as well. Okay. And so, and that's why already starting from 85, and I started to develop the first software, which was for big computers at that time. We didn't have personal computers at that time. So we started to design software for training based on the rate of adaptation. Which is entering athlete's history of training, which is important, what you did, what your performances, age, gender, event, some other parameters as well, duration of the season. And software designs you optimal progression of volumes based on supposed rate of adaptation, which is based on our studies that we did. So we need to know exactly what rate of adaptation is. It's not linear adaptation. Okay, normally is S-shaped curve adaptation. That's why you need to design season accordingly. And maybe even sometimes change the season based if swimmers adapting faster or slower. Mm-hmm. And now we have actually already algorithms and software that helps us even to manage weekly, daily training based on the rate of adaptation. So that's pretty sophisticated, a lot of math, a lot of mathematical modeling. And I'm doing that for already almost 40 years.
So the teams that you work with, I mean, I think I heard that you come into Mark Schubert, is that right? Does he use you?
Yeah, I was with Mark, Rick Schubert, yeah.
Oh, Rick Schubert, how about Mark Schubert?
Mark Schubert as well, but yes. We worked on some different projects with Mark and Rick. So I worked basically with many coaches. As you probably know, I was director of sports science and physiology for USA Swimming for almost 10 years. During my tenure as director of sports science, so I did a lot of research as well as practical application on the research. And we didn't do only training design. Training design is part of, obviously, important part of our research. But we also did lactate tests, especially lactate clearance test at the competitions. Mostly awards with national team division. So that's why all swimmers who have been on national team Olympic team members, so they've been testing with me, and now we continue to work with many of them, with their coaches as well. And we also did back in 2006 we started to develop quantifying swimming technique, because I always was skeptical about ideal swimming technique, as we had many meetings with Richard Quick at that time, like Mark Schubert, national team coaches, Dave Salo, and many others on a national team. And then we discuss, and I've heard many talks for coaches. Oh, this is ideal swimming technique. Mm-hmm. What is ideal? Okay, yeah. how we can measure that? As a scientist, I want to measure what is ideal swimming technique. And then suddenly, 10 years after that, nobody's looking for this ideal swimming technique. Coaches telling other ideal swimming technique already, other people. So what happened to ideal swimming technique 10 years ago, 5 years ago? Okay, who is looking at that? Nobody's looking, because swimmers are swimming faster. They always improving. That's why once we started to measure, once we developed swim power technology, we understood that there is no ideal swimming technique, that we can swim way faster. We are not even approaching ideal swimming technique. So based on biomechanical research and modeling that we are doing right now, we know that at least from biomechanical standpoint of view, if you combine different phases of stroke, let's say freestyle, let's say who is the best in the world at the beginning of the stroke? Who is the best in the world in the middle of the stroke? Who is the best in the world at the end of the stroke? Finishing the stroke. Who is the best in the breathing technique, losing less speed than others or not losing at all? Who is the best in the kicking technique? So once you combine several swimmers picking up the best phases, not let's say ideal swimming technique, as some coaches talking. So I don't believe in it. I know we have data that there is no ideal swimming technique. Everybody is doing mistakes. But if we will combine best phases that we know from different swimmers, let's say 3, 4, even 5 swimmers in one, we did modeling for 100 freestyle, world record will be 3 seconds faster than the current world record, 43.9. That's how fast we know how to swim today, if we do ideal swimming technique, as we see that from our research. Right. And that will be just technique. I'm not talking about training improvements. Right. Not only what recovery improvements, nutrition, and some other things that can be done to improve athletes' performances. So that's why there are so many different things, including this rate of adaptation training introduced. So then coaches will not guess what kind of training needs to be done. They will know exactly what they need to do next week, what they need to do following week, and so on. So therefore, we can swim way faster than 43.9. And that's when people are breaking world records. Let's say Caleb Dressel did 46.95, yeah? Or not 46.95, 100, but 100 butterfly. He did 48.
He go 48. Yes.
In Tokyo, yeah. So, well, I know it's broke 100 of the second. I should remember the numbers better.
Right. I forgot too. It's funny. I'm thinking I can find it out really quickly here, but
Yeah.
But you think.
No, he did 49.45. Correct.
Yeah, that's right. I didn't think he went 48. Okay. Yeah, no, 42 in yards, though. Yeah.
But 500 of seconds, obviously, it's exciting to see world record. But when I know that we can swim 3 seconds faster than that. So I'm thinking, that's not fast.
You know, you're the first one I have asked every coach. And, you know, one of the things I bring up is if you compare swimming to running and you say, Usain Bolt, we want you to be part of the 4x400, or we'd like you to run a 1500 meters. Now, he'd probably do okay, right? And if there wasn't anybody to beat him, he'd look like he was really good all the way through the spectrum of the different events, right? But he really wouldn't be. So then you look at Ledecky. Now, the reason running's been around for a long time and lots of people run and lots of people can run. And there are a lot of good coaches. I would guess that coach by coach, if you look at the percentage of coaches that had college educations in science that coach swimming versus running, we might actually be maybe a little ahead, especially in the United States. Swimming might be a little ahead, but there's so many people running that you're finding such a massive talent pool that you wouldn't expect Usain Bolt to do that. And yet, you know, you see all these people, you see Michael Phelps on the 4x1 relay and setting the world record in the 400 IM. My point on that was, you know, or Ledecky's even worse, right? She's 1500 and they put her on the 4x1, 4x2 relay. It's crazy. And she set the American record once in the 400 IM. I think what they're doing, and I say it this way to be nice, I mean, just to be kind of funny, is Ledecky's sort of rubbing our nose in it. If you're ahead in training and you're ahead in stroke, and you've been willing to do what it takes for speed as well as middle, you know, lactate tolerance, lactate production, and you've been willing to go the long stuff to be really good and totally aerobically fit, you can beat almost anybody who is willing to do that. But my point was somewhat, you look at Petey and you say, okay, there's a guy that might be the future, even though, as you say, he'd probably go a lot faster. As a biomechanist, I see mistakes in Petey's stroke that would make him a lot faster, as probably you do. Maybe in his training, but he has that one thing where he's focused on one thing and does it really, really, really well. And I wonder if you would agree with me that might be the future. We're going to find that people have a certain talent and they better stick to that talent, because there's going to be so much better training and better strokes at the higher levels of the other events that they won't be competitive in those other events if they try to spread themselves out too much. That said, I think age groupers should all do the 400 IM. That's just my thing, to find out what they're good at.
I mean, there are a lot of biomechanical, physiological reasons for that we explain. And I agree with most of the stuff that you told. But let's take Katie Ledecky, okay? She swims between 100 and 1500.
Right.
Yeah. So, but what she is the best question? She's the best probably 400, 800. Maybe 1500, okay? And how we can evaluate that? It's very simple. You look at relative endurance. Ratio between times show relative endurance. And we've been doing that for 35 years already. I did my PhD on that, okay? And I'm surprised that coaches still don't know what is relative endurance.
It's crazy.
Yeah. So it's such a simple parameter, ratio between times. And we have computer software online, Talent ID and Development, which we launched last year. Quite a few countries already using, and quite a few teams already. In fact, I will talk to Ron Aitken from St. Piper's two weeks. He will be here at Olympic Training Center in Colorado Springs, where I'm working.
Is that
and,
right?
We'll be testing his swimmers' swimming technique, but also we'll be discussing about involvement of his team in this Talent ID database. Which is completely different topics. It's a huge database with multiple software inside. And he's very interested in that. He's interested in science. He's using my software for training design, as you probably know, for many years already, eCoach software for seasonal training design. So Talent ID is more about long-term performance progression. Okay. And it has also part such as analysis of relative endurance. What is your relative endurance? Relative endurance will tell you exactly what event you should swim. Okay. You don't need to guess. It's simple ratio between times, and you know what event you need to swim. Okay. And also it will give you ideas what you should change in your training. Many coaches at coaches clinics asking me, what kind of training to do? You need to do. Should I do USRPT or should I do aerobic training or should I do some other training? I'm telling them, give me your numbers, your best swimmers times. And I'll tell you right away what kind of training would your swimmers need to do. If your ratio between times like Michael Andrew, there is no way he will benefit from USRPT training. If your ratio is like Katie Ledecky, she will benefit from USRPT.
So he's already done enough of the USRPT training in order to find out where his max is. He needs to do the other training. You agree? Right.
And the problem is that I like Michael, you know, and his parents. I know his parents pretty well as well. I spoke to them quite a few times, and I disagree what they did in long-term training because they lost sensitive periods of development of aerobic conditioning. Now will be very tough to pick up this aerobic condition. He'll need to spend much more time instead of doing that when he was young. So that's why his relative endurance is out of chart. Nobody in the world has such a high ratio between times as he has, okay? Even Caleb Dressel has much lower ratio between times.
There's a 1% difference that we calculate. Yeah, there's a 1% difference between doubling his 50 and subtracting it from his 100. Caleb Dressel and Michael Andrew. Caleb Dressel's better anaerobically fit, that's what we suppose. And the thing is, Caleb Dressel is just as fast or faster. So, you know, you could say, well, genetically, Andrew has so much more speed that we can't expect him to swim the 200 or the whatever. And he tries to expect himself to do that, which is, I think, a really good thing. Because a lot of sprinters don't even want to touch the 200. It hurts too much, you know. And yet you see him fall apart. Also, the choice of splits relative to his fitness, to go out that fast when you know, or you should know, that you can't go out that fast and still come back that slow. It's sort of embarrassing. I would think it would be embarrassing. I think at that moment you would say, okay, let's listen to Dr. G and see where it is that we can make the improvement. Now, I want to go back to what you just said. When, because I agree with you 100%, the aerobic system in humans comes first, then you get the power with the difference of the hormones changing and all the other things that, you know, all the things happening. So how much endurance should a wannabe world-class age group swimmer do? Because there's obviously a lot of controversy, especially with this movement to USRPT and people thinking, well, they'll just sprint. And it'd be interesting to see Dave's opinion on this, but I would guess you've had some pretty good conversations there. What do you do with an 11, 12-year-old? Because Dave will say, my 11, 12-year-old, when she first hit the Olympic trials time and then hit the Olympics at 13, had never gone a 200 in practice. And yet, you know, she was she was a silver medalist, I think, in a 200. What about that? And that's not just an anecdote, though. How much faster would she have been? And what would you say to someone that has a 9, 10, 11, 12-year-old who has shown, loves the sport, loves to train? How far should they go? How often should they go that far?
So we develop models. In this talent ID system that we have, we develop models how much every swimmer should train, depending if you are sprint, mid, or middle and distance swimmer, depending if you are girl or boy. So, it should match your sensitive periods of development, okay? As you mentioned as well. So if you are at the age 10, 11, that's a good age for girls start increase volumes in training, okay? Understand there are differences between sprinters and distance swimmers or mid-distance swimmers, but even sprinters need some level of aerobic conditioning. Mm-hmm. Because if you look at the top sprinters in the world, look at Gary Hall Jr., okay, look at Nathan Adrian, look at Caleb Dressel. They used to swim longer distances. But mm-hmm. Nathan was great 500 swimmer when he was young, okay? Same with Gary Hall Jr. He was not afraid to swim 500s at the competitions, okay? Look at Michael Phelps. At the end of career, he was probably better on 100 than 200 because he with age, you are building more power, testosterone, and other things, the other changes happen in the body. So you become more and more powerful because that's sensitive periods of development. Right. So, but when he was younger, he was swimming 1500. I remember when he was 18 years old, he was swimming at national championship 1500. Mm-hmm. Same with Ryan Lochte back in 2004. Was it 2000? No, maybe 2004 at Olympic trials. He qualified for the finals in 1500 freestyle. Is this his event? No. Why he was swimming? Coach Greg Troy can answer pretty good. He's a great coach who understood why it's important to maintain aerobic fitness conditioning. Mm-hmm. And you gave example of Dave. Dave is on opposite spectrum, probably. He likes sprint to do, and he believes in the sprint, which I believe too. If your aerobic conditioning is good, but if your aerobic conditioning is not, you're limiting your potential. So his swimmer probably could swim much faster. Maybe not much, but could win gold medals, maybe multiple gold medals even, okay? And we're limiting at this potential if we are not developing aerobic conditioning. Why? Very simple. It's not only sensitive periods of development, but also aerobic conditioning gives you a chance to recover faster, gives you a chance to do more good quality sets in practices, good aerobic conditioning. And as a result, you're improving more. Your lactate clearance is faster, your heart rate recovery is faster, your resting heart rate is lower. There are so many benefits keeping good conditioning. Then on top of that, you should develop your anaerobic sprint conditioning. So, but that should not happen at age 10, 11, or 12. You can do some sprint practices, but there are certain number of volumes you need to do, accomplish like aerobic volumes before hitting really serious anaerobic work.
Yeah, no, that would be one of the things people would ask is, okay, I've got this swimmer. She's, look at Claire right now. Ron's got Claire Weinstein. Oh my gosh, I saw her warming up and I said, that's one of the best swimmers I've ever seen. Her stroke is actually more balanced and it seems to have a better feel than even Katie. And I'm watching her warm up with the other three Olympians, with at La Mirada a couple of weeks ago with Ron. And I'm like, that is remarkable. And I tracked it down who her age group coach was. And she's very, very particular about the same warm-up every day, exactly the same warm-up with exactly the same stroke rate. They look like they're water ballet when they're warming up. And they do 40 minutes of that no matter what. So if they get it with enough water time, they always do that warm-up. So they're very, very particular. So, but Claire is 6 foot tall. And you have to wonder, what is she? Is she a sprinter? She's 14. So is she a sprinter? Is she a distance swimmer? Now with her, in her case, the average, I always say this, the average coach in America, and this is sad, I don't mean it to be mean, but the average coach in America who doesn't use science, who had Michael Phelps or even Katie, would have put him anchor on the relay team. They would have been the best swimmer, best sprinter at the high school. They would have gone to college on a scholarship in sprints. But they probably would have never found out how really good they could have been. And my point of that is, how many people are doing that right now around the world that really aren't finding out what a swimmer is? And I would get back to the conversation about how do you tell if they're a sprinter middle distance at an age group level? Even with Claire, I'm not sure you can. I think it's too early. Do you?
No, it's not too early. I can tell you right now.
Really?
Give me your results, best times, and I'll tell you what she is going to swim when she will be older. Relative endurance at that age, she's 14, correct?
Yeah.
So relative endurance at that age should be a little bit lower than elite level swimmers. So therefore she will be slightly more sprint oriented once she will be older, 18, 19, 20 years old or postgrad, right, if she will still be swimming at that time. So therefore at this age, she should have certain relative endurance. And I think Ron is doing a good job. You know, he was always more focused on aerobic training than anaerobic training. And I'll just give you an example. One day I came to Olympic Training Center a few years ago. He was here with the camp and discussed with him testing schedule of swimming technique. And I see the practice on the board, like a 32 times 100 kick. I thought, why 32? Why not 30? Yeah. Why not 35, you know?
How do you know? Yeah.
Yeah. Ron tells, that's what your software told me to do.
Oh.
He's following just right at the point, the software, science, because software is built on the science. And so as a result, he is always learning himself how his swimmers are adapting and what they're doing. What they need to do, basically. And I'm very glad that he is so scientifically oriented. That's why he's successful. Mm-hmm. He's not looking overnight success, jump on the USRPT training, tomorrow or a few weeks from now or months from now, we'll be very fast. Yes, you'll be very fast. But what's next? And there are so many examples that I can give you. Swimmers who jumped on your type of USRPT training, power, strength, sprint, and they stop improvements and then disappeared from sport. I'll give you an example from my home country, Ruta Melutite, who won 2012 Olympics at age 15, beating Rebecca Sonny 100 breaststroke in London. What happened with her? She was 15 years old. A couple of years, 1.5 years before Olympics, she moved to Great Britain to work with John Root, which is a great coach. I don't have any doubt, but he's very sprint oriented. He's a good friend of Dave, and they are doing they work together a little bit. He was learning from him. He mentioned me, but at the same time, he doesn't recognize that there is aerobic conditioning as well, and eventually. She started to swim. She broke world record. Everything's great. She started to swim slower, slower, and slower. And then she just, after Rio Olympics, which was disaster, I told him before that, John, you need to change. Okay, you cannot be just so stubborn and just think I had success in this type of training and I'm continuing doing this.
Yeah.
You need to adapt to athletes. She lost all her aerobic conditioning. And as a result, I already predicted back in 2013 when she broke world record that if she will continue at this type of training, she will not be swimming fast in 2016 Olympics. Nobody believed me, including the Lithuanian Swimming Federation. They continued to pour money in this athlete, but I thought she's done if she's continued training this way.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, one of the ways I try to explain it to coaches who won't have the science or won't go that direction is imagine. I mean, and Greg Troy and I talked about it one time too. Greg was like, I've done US. In fact, he had just had Michael on in a training camp. And he goes, did Michael convert you? We're all laughing about this. And he goes, you know, you and I have been doing sprint training. I mean, USRPT training for a long time. We do it, but not exclusively. And it's kind of like saying, okay, your maximum bench press is I'll say it in pounds, but 300 pounds. And every day you go in, and you bench press 290 pounds to 300 pounds every day, what will you feel like by the end of the week? I mean, you just have to put it that way. If the person, here's what's happening. As a biomechanist, I watch underwater. The thing that gets me is you're talking about not scientific training in terms of progression and a plan and all that stuff in terms of physiology, but in terms of biomechanics. I talk to, you know, I've been doing this Zoom now with a lot of world-class coaches, World Swimming Coach Association have me do it and everything. And I'll ask things like, you know, how many strokes they typically will maybe know that, but what's your swimmer's a world record holder in the 100 breaststroke, 200 breaststroke. What's your best 100 breaststroke pull time? No idea. How often do you video underwater? Well, I have somebody to do that, which is great. If you got somebody really good to do that, that's awesome. If you lived at the training center with the 6 cameras there, that'd be great. They took out the flume, which I think was a mistake, but anyway, you know, what happens is they're trying to go full blast every day, but what happens is they can't. And so what happens in bench press when you can't? You arch your back, you push up, you drop your elbow, you slice the water. Even if your finger can't hold on all out every day, if you've got a good feel for the water by the end of the week, you're done. Rich, you probably remember Rick Sharp, Dr. Rick Sharp, remember him?
Yeah, I know Rick pretty well.
He used to say most coaches that come to the training center kill their swimmers by Wednesday and then just drag them through the rest of the week. Would that be your experience too? And has that changed at all?
I mean, it changes a little bit. I'm sure coaches understand much better now based on my current experience working with coaches who are coming to altitude training. So they're not doing that anymore. I mean, maybe somebody who is very young and inexperienced, so they probably do that. But right now we know about long-term, this adaptation at altitude much more than we knew before. That's why it's a good coaches education already happening. And I'm running a lot of clinics as well for coaches, primarily in swimming, but also in some other sports as well. That's why coaches probably understand much better. It's occasionally, maybe some young coach may do this mistake.
Well, I mean, again, are you seeing that? I mean, again, I'm looking at the workout I got today from a coach. And, you know, it's 1 100 at 130 swim, 225s at 35 one 100 at 130 swim, two 25s at 35, et cetera. We'll go down here, nine 300s at 430. But there's no place in here for how fast the swimmer is supposed to go. And when you look at Ron's workouts, you see that there's a progression that he expects and that he's showing what they did before on the same set. So he's looking for progressions. I'm sure that has a lot to do with you and maybe to some extent me. When I wrote my software in Excel, there was always, we used Rick Sharp's stress. That's the first time anybody used stress as far as we know. We had never seen anybody. Now you say you're working on yours in 1985, so you were ahead of us. We just didn't see you. We saw high tech. And when I looked at high tech, I went, this is nice and neat. And everybody thinks they're doing the right thing. It looks really nice, but what are you really accomplishing? You go the same 10 100s on 130, and you don't even mention whether or not the swimmer you're training goes a 50 point, a 45, or a 55, or a 105. The same set of 10 100s and 130, and no expectation of a difference between those swimmers. And as you say, are you a sprinter? Are you a middle distance swimmer? What's your, let's just say, forget it. Forget whether or not they really are. They have the goal to win the NCAAs. In the 100 fly, and maybe they're not really a 100 flyer, but they went, it happens in high school in America all the time. You want to win the 100 fly. I just had a girl this morning at 5 in the morning. She wants to win the 100 fly. I'm like, you're a distance swimmer. Yeah, but they don't have distance in high school. But so that's my second event. Can you make me better in the 100 fly? I'm like, the first thing I ask her is, she's coached by somebody else. All my swimmers are coached by somebody else. I said, okay, what's your best 100 dolphin kick time? No idea. What's your 50 dolphin kick? I don't know. If you're going to swim the 100 fly, you kind of better know that, and you better know what it was today, and then set a goal for it, right? Does this all, it just makes sense, right? But you work with the best of the best at coming to the Olympic Training Center. I still remember John Trope telling me, dummy down your talk, Steve. I go, I'm not a PhD in physiology. He goes, no. We had somebody here for 2 weeks. And at the end of 2 weeks, the guy one of the coaches raised his hands and said, we've solved the problem. This is going to make you laugh, I hope. We've solved the problem with lactic acid. And John looks down at him and goes, I'm interested to hear. Well, how'd you solve it? He goes, we don't let them drink milk. I kid you not. That was what he said, lactose. And so he said, be very careful how you speak to people, because you're just going to go. And I go, I'm not trying to go over their head. I'm trying to make them go back to their team and come back. I won't even do a clinic anymore if people don't give me their best times of the year before and their best times now. So I can do the data, because they haven't, most of them haven't. And then when I leave for the year after, they have to commit to me the year after, that it improves. And if it didn't, I'm staying in my chair. I'm going to stay in California. Does that frustrate you sometimes? You'll go in and do something with people and then they don't do it?
Yeah, I mean, there are plenty of cases like that as well. People, let's say I'm doing some biomechanical tests on swimming technique, coming to visit the team, or team is coming here. And then after 6 months or so, they want to retest again. I'm coming, testing again, nothing changed. Huh. So, did you do the drills that I told you to do? Yeah, we tried the drills. How often? Oh, we did 200, let's say, one week, other week we did 300. Then we just occasionally doing 200 or 300 easy swim. But listen, if you want to break your habit that you have, mistake, you have to do that regularly and at high speed as well. Because drills that we develop are forcing swimmers to swim correctly. Change technique. But if you are not doing that, if you're doing, let's say, 3% of your practice drills, 97% of practice old style swimming that you used to swim, how many chances do you have to change your habits? Probably very little. You have to do maybe not 50, but at least 30, 40% of work with new swimming technique. But you're not going to swim new swimming technique until you develop new habits. That's why the drills that we're developing are forcing swimmers to swim correctly. And we have hundreds of drills, depending on what mistakes swimmers are doing. And recently we started to develop super drills, which is combination of different drills, especially if swimmer is doing several mistakes, which is very typical. It's not one mistake you're doing. You're doing two, three, even four sometimes mistakes. You combine three, four drills in one, that's your super drill. And do the main set in practice as a super drill. Why you need to swim your old technique and continue strengthening your old habits? You will never improve your swimming technique.
You know, I was talking to Ron about how often he videos, and you know, we have great conversations. And I mean, it's not like there's any disrespect or whatever. We both respect each other very much. But when he told me, I went, you need to video more. And better yet, you need the swimmer to videotape themselves, video themselves. You know, it's a digital time. They can just pick it up. They can go a series of and see themselves literally every single time there's a break, which in Ron's case isn't very often. But but there's, you know, whenever there's a break, they can see themselves, or they can just videotape the video the whole workout. I still say videotape because I'm an old guy, but video the whole workout and just look at where they were at different points to see what's falling apart. One of the things mechanically that's difficult for me is two things. First, you give them a beautiful stroke. And I'm saying, like, I tell them, look, I'm not a ballet instructor. I'm not a gymnastics instructor. I'm not a dance instructor, but I can make you look beautiful at a slow enough speed or even a fast speed for one lap of the pool. The point is, can you do it for the duration of your race? One of the most frustrating things I see, this would be great for us to do. I didn't know we were going to talk about biomechanics. I thought you were just a physiology guy. But if we looked underwater at the Olympic Games, you and I could pick out all kinds of things, not only energetically, where they're falling apart at different parts of the race, or maybe they went out too fast, whatever, but we'd see things that mechanically are wrong. One of the major pet peeves I have are people bending their knees on the recovery phase of the dolphin and the flutter kick, because they can't. And here's what we can find out is if we measure their strength in their hip extensors, their strength in their hip extensors is too weak. And part of the reason is they're kicking on a kickboard and there's no resistance on the up kick because their legs are already on the top of the water. And when they kick underwater, when they're in their full stroke, they now have to pull their leg up straight. So when you watch Ryan Lochte and you watch Caleb Dressel, coincidentally on the same team, they kick with a straight leg on the up kick and there's no resistance there. But swimmers that don't have the strength to do it bend their knees so that they bring in the biceps femoris and other muscles to make them stronger, which is great when you're kicking a soccer ball, but not so great when you have resistance in the water, right? But you'll see it almost every, if you look at every heat, even of the finals of the Olympic Games, you'll see people doing that. And my point to them is you have to, when you get to the weight room, you can't be doing squats and expect to be great in flutter kick. Another thing I was going to bring up, and the reason I know this, and that I was so sure of it, and he had to prove it to me, was, do you know Dr. Mike Yeses? He's from Russia too. He does a lot of Russian stuff too. He edited the Soviet Sport Journal.
I don't know. Probably pronunciation or last name is different because Yeses doesn't sound like Russian. Yeah.
Y-E-S-S-I-S, Yeses. But he's the first one that taught me if you're over 3 degrees in the motion, off in the motion when you train it, it's not going to give you the results that you're expecting in the motion that you want. Would you agree with that? And would you agree with that, when you get in the weight room, you should be testing to see whether or not what you're seeing in the water that's a mistake can be improved by strength?
Yeah, absolutely. So in general, land training should be, the more specific, the better. We are not weightlifters, okay? If we are trying to build just athleticism in the gym, you know, weight room. So I don't think it's a good idea. You need to be very specific what you need. Okay, and that's why one of the tests we're also doing, it's so-called land-water strength test, where we're measuring strength on land, then strength in the water. We're looking at transition of your specific strength from land to the water, which is simple ratio between these two parameters. We're looking pull, kick, swim power or strength in the water. Then we're looking at the combination, how combining your kick and pull in a full body swim. Is it effective combination or not? And over the years, we found that swimmers are different, okay? Some of them are better in combination, some of them not as good in combination. So that leads to the idea that how much you need to do pull and kick in practices separately from this test. We can tell exactly the numbers. That also leads how much you need to do drowning training. If you are too strong, you're not using your strength in the water, your transition is very low, and you still continue building strength on land, it's very questionable why you need to be stronger on land and carry this all the muscles in the water sinking as some elite level swimmers are doing. And they still continue building strength on land.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's an ego thing. I think it's step up to the block and
transition from land to the water. That's what's important for you. You're already too strong on land. Forget about land in this case. Some swimmers are too weak. They would benefit from land. So, and definitely land has to be specific. I completely agree with you.
I wasn't completely convinced until I was coaching and I had a girl go 36 pull-ups. And she, you know, she did very well. She dropped, you know, 40 seconds in the 400 IM in one season. We thought we were doing great. So on the same team, the same high school team, I was coaching a USS team, but they were the same high school team. John Mikkonen shows up and he was on the same team, but in the morning, he wasn't able to get to Nova. So he would train with me and Tom Milich in the morning. And so we would try to fix his stroke because it was a train wreck. And so we would do what we could. So he comes in and we say, hey, you know, Debbie just did 36 pull-ups. How many can you do? So he comes in and he goes, gets on the bar and he goes to do a pull-up. And he's like one of these, just on the first one. And he barely gets his chin over. And then he comes up and he can't do another one. So we're all laughing at him, right? 2 weeks later, he sets the American record in the 800 free. And in our relay, he goes 20 point in the 50 free for the high school relay. And I went, Yeses, you were right. Pull-ups is dropping your elbows. It's the worst thing you can teach someone. And the relationship between how many pull-ups, now I will grant them this. If you could do two pull-ups and you were kind of a wimp, you know, you just weren't strong. And then you got to where you could do 20 pull-ups. You're probably going to be better in the water, but not for the reason that people think. Do you agree? You should be working on the rotators. You know, if this is what you're going to do, shouldn't you be doing these? You agree with me there?
Yeah, absolutely. As I thought, that's specific strength again. Yeah, pull-ups are good to be strong. And so I can do also right now 22 pull-ups.
I learned that way. Okay.
For girl, 36 pull-ups, that's amazing. You know, I don't think she needs to so many pull-ups. Okay.
No, she didn't.
She needs to be more specific. And definitely motion in the pull-ups, your arm stroke technique in the water is different. Okay. So therefore you need to do different type of work. And again, you need to measure regularly. So that's why we have a variety of tests offering to swim teams, including this land water strength test, which will tell how much you need to do work on land, how much you need to do work in the water to be successful.
So let me just ask you, I mean, maybe you're giving away trade secrets or something, but let me know. But how do you measure? I use an isokinetic device that Doc Councilman designed. It's called a mini gym. It's a very simple device, but it gives you, it's not exactly power, but we call it power because we can tell relative improvement and relative strength. So if a person can get a certain number on this motion and then can do a certain amount of motions at that average number, then we relate that to what they can do in the pool. And as we see improvements in one, we see a very close to one-to-one relationship. And then to keep their shoulder in one piece, we go the other way too. Now, what do you use to be able to tell those?
We do static strength on land. And I know that the dynamic strength that you are measuring, it's a little bit probably better correlates with swimming performances. But the problem I see with many things, you need to have really good database to advise swimmers and coaches what they need to do.
That's right.
You can do a lot of math statistics, you know, to calculate what kind of training you need to do. And that's what we have already, this land water strength test we're using for. I was still doing my bachelor studies. I did already studies on land water strength in swimming. So that's why we have 40 years data. And we have many Olympic champions data as well. And once we have this data, then you can tell what swimmers need to do. Okay, but if you are occasionally testing just lower level of swimmers, you don't know what elite level swimmers can do with this.
That's right. Absolutely. Yeah.
So that's why testing is tricky as well. You need to convince coaches to test and swimmers convinced to test and give them valuable information. If you're not giving valuable information, they are not interested to test. Okay.
Now, whenever I learn something like this Zoom, whenever I learn something, I want to share it with the world, you know, and I don't, it's funny because my swimmers, when we first came up with a set called critical velocity, and all it is as many hundreds as you can do on a given interval. If you make it for 45 minutes, you get 15 minutes to do whatever you want. That's the deal I have with the swimmers. If you miss, you go for the whole hour, but you tell how many you made on that interval and you have to rest 30 seconds for each one you made. It's not particularly scientific in one way, but it's very motivating. And Ernie Miglischko said it's more accurate. We think your critical velocity set is more accurate than lactate testing. He was coaching college at the time. He goes, if my swimmer drinks a beer that night, their lactate test is completely screwed up. At least with critical velocity, you know what's going on for day after day. But it was kind of a funny thing he said. But my swimmers were tiffed because I'm telling everybody, I wrote this thing in Swimming World, and they're telling everybody, and they were improving faster than any. We had the world data from the International Swimming Statisticians before anybody did. And we took that data and we showed the percentage improvement of everyone ranked in the top 100 in the world. And then we showed what you just said, their drop-off rate between different distances. And there, we didn't do it by velocity, but we did it by percentage differences.
Yes.
Kind of the same, right? So they knew we had an advantage. And we were just a little team in Northern Nevada, but we were 5,000 feet, which helped. But we were killing everybody. And they said, why are you telling everyone? And I said, you know, it's like, we can tell them everything. You think they're really going to do it, you know? And then if they're going to do it, are they going to do too much of it? Are they going to plan it? Are they going to try to do maximum best for us every day? Are you going to USRPT every day or something? So I said, I'm not worried about that. I said all that to say, can you show me what you're using? Or is it just proprietary and you only do it with the swimmers you work with?
I mean, no, I published multiple articles, including on the Swimming World magazine as well. And also, USA Swimming publications as well. I'm doing many clinics every year, teaching coaches. So it's not nothing secretly, you know. Like on land, you're testing strength on land, static strength on land in the middle of the stroke using a tensiometer. So then in the water, again, using tensiometer, we're using peak force, measuring peak force in three different positions, sprinting basically, pull, kick, and swim.
You're using a velocity meter or a tensiometer?
No, in this test particular, we're using tensiometer.
Even in the water?
That's correct. We are not.
Well, you need to show me that. I've never, that's what I mean. Would it be great?
You're not reading my article, Steve.
What's that?
Already back in early 2000s when I moved to the United States to work with USA Swimming.
Yes, but who knows? I'm telling you, you got to remember, you work with a very finite number of coaches. And do you think that well, let me ask you that. If the average, I was thinking about buying a lactate monitor just to have it. But there's a point where coaches, I mean, can an average coach use a tensiometer and do what you're doing if we taught them to?
Several coaches have been asking me where to purchase and how to use that. I was teaching them, and I don't know how many of them are using right now, but coaches can do that regularly. And it's not difficult. As long as you know the numbers, understand what's transition of strength from land to the water should be in different strokes, in different gender, what coefficient of combination between pull, kick, and swim should be, then you can compare these numbers and decide what direction your training should go. Do I need to increase strength on land or strength in the water? Do I need to increase kicking, pulling, or increase full body swim? So maybe you don't need too much pulling, kicking practices, because you already have very strong pulling kick, but you cannot combine well. Maybe you need to increase pulling kick separate because your combination is already very high. How much you can increase more? If you build working on components of your strength, such as pull and kick, you'll be more successful than working on a full body swim if your full body swim is already very good. So that's why it's simple tests at the beginning of the season or a few times a season will tell you what direction you should point your training.
And if what you're doing is working, right? I mean, it's okay to change, right? If it's not working.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I know, but the thing is, you're not going to change if you think what you're doing is working. And there's so many variables that people, I think, just throw up their hands and go, I'm just going to do what my coach did. I'm just going to do what I read in Swimming World or even my thing, Competitive Swimmer, where they see, oh, yeah, well, this is what Rocco Meering's doing. So that's what I'm going to do. He's got Schoenmacher I'm good enough with that. I'll just do what he does. This is the problem with anecdotal thinking. This is another thing. And this is a pet peeve of mine for USA Swimming. Is we know they now have, they didn't. Back when I was first doing this, Bob Steele had me speak at the training center because I was doing a distance camp there. And he pulled me over. He goes, I've heard you before. Can you talk to us? And I said, I'm right off the pool deck and my blood pressure is kind of high. And I'm kind of like, I look at everybody and I go, what's this place cost? Because this is awesome. And they told me the millions of dollars. And I said, what's the average improvement of an American swimmer? Somebody pick a stroke, 200 back, somebody said. I said, what's the average improvement of American swimmer who's ranked in the top 100 for the last year or the last 4 years? Does anybody know? I've got Johnny, who I think is awesome, but I've got some really smart people there. Nobody knew. And now they know, at least they can know. Back then they literally would complain. They said, look, we understand.
What year was it?
1990.
Okay,
1980 something, 1989 to 1991, somewhere.
Okay.
In there.
Yeah, I moved only in January of 2000 to work with Josef Sumik. I would answer this question very simple, okay?
I know you would have. Yeah, well, that's kind of my point. No, wait, let me get to this point. So then I went to Nick. I had already gone to Nick Theory, and I showed them on my big old honking Mac that I brought in for my training. I showed them what we did. We had taken all that data, and we distilled it, and we said, look how China's improving faster than the rest of us at a rate that doesn't make sense. We literally knew the Chinese were cheating before they did, before even... Well, I knew the Chinese knew they were cheating, like the Germans knew they were cheating. But we could see that their drop-off rates were insanely good. And we called it drop-off, adding the two lower events and then subtracting. Yeah. And their improvement rates were faster too. So, and of course they were different swimmers. Didn't matter who they were improving faster. So I'm like, well, they got a billion people. Maybe they're just finding the right people. That's what my naivety thought. But here was the point is that now though, they have all this data. USA, Nick Theory told me too. They're calling me from the training center, asking the best historical times for the swimmers who live at the training center. And he's just laughing. He goes, what are they doing with the science? And so Nick was way ahead of everybody. You know, he used to do it on cards and then he'd on computer. So my point now is though, I'm trying to find out what the average improvement is. What's the average improvement of an 11, 12 year old who ends up being world-class or swims for the rest of their lives? Because, you know, we can fry an 11, 12-year-old to be maybe a little faster than they would have been if they hadn't been trained like a senior too young. Or we can not, as you say, not give them enough aerobic background to ever get to the point where they can, maybe Michael Andrews' point, where they can ever get to the point where they can get to their potential. I think that with a big enough N, we could find that out. Now, maybe you have it, but my point to all of USA Swimming, we can't get them to release this, is give me by LSE, give me by state, give me by team, the average improvement, then we'll reverse engineering and engineer it. And here's what I think they're going to find is the teams that hired you to come in and say, oh, no, this is how you really develop it, are going to improve at a faster rate. But shouldn't the rest of us be able to see that that's happening? Because parents are firing coaches that are doing a great job, but they don't know it because they don't have the world record holder. You know, what's the chance of having a world record holder? So anyway, that's a long-winded way to say, what can we do about that? What should we do about it?
I mean, we already did that, quite frankly. Yeah, okay. Yeah. You can go and look at our Talent ID system that we developed. And that's combination of multiple software for performance progression at every age, how much athletes should perform progression in order to reach certain level, let's say Olympic level or national level, you know, NCAA finals and other stuff. So you can enter any times you want and you will know your progression, how much you need progress every year in order to reach results.
Can we tell norm? Can we tell what the norm is?
Yes, we can tell everything.
Okay. From across how many, what's the N on that? How many people?
In the database?
Yeah.
In the database, we have probably close to 1,000 swimmers in different strokes, okay? And so we know how much the swimmers improved every year from age 10 until age of peak performances.
This is 1,000 total or 1,000 for each age group? Or?
Total, yeah, okay.
So how many would you say for each age group?
I'm not looking for each, because every swimmer was going through every age group, okay? Let's say Caleb Dressel.
Okay.
He was 10, age 10, age 11, age 12. He went through all age groups.
Okay, great.
So we are looking at dynamic changes. You're not looking at the just age groups, because age groups may lead to mistakes.
I know.
How elite level swimmers progressing, that's a different thing. And again, I published this first article when I moved to the United States back in 2000. I did my PhD on that also, in performance progression of elite level swimmers. And we created the models, how your progression should be. And these models, as I told, are now online in the Talent ID and Development database.
Where do we find that, on the USA Swimming site?
No, I'm not working with USA Swimming for already 10 years plus.
I see that. Oh, it's Olympic. So where do you find it?
It's on our website. Actually, it's on the other website right now, but we are moving now in our website. And I can send you the link.
Okay.
But you will not access too much because it's... password protected and other stuff here. But I can show you a lot of different things. Obviously, we don't have too much time now. In fact, I'm flying to Atlanta soon in a few hours, so I have to go.
Well, I'd love to continue this with real life, where we actually look at season plans, where we look at stroke as a relative. There are fine things in stroke that I don't find in very many books. Rhythm. You don't find a chapter on rhythm very much. And yet rhythm is so incredibly important. And one of the most frustrating things, especially for breaststrokers, right? They can get just a little out of rhythm and it seems like the whole thing just falls apart.
Yeah, swimming slower. That's very simple, you know? And that's what I told leads the sprint training. And this mentioned swimmer Ruta Melutite, who lost completely rhythm, okay? It's a fraction of the second you're losing in swimming slower. And instead of world record 104.35, she swims, I think, 107 in Rio. What happened?
Yeah.
You make like a 2.5 seconds slower or almost 3 seconds slower. Just doesn't make any sense. And that's last of the rhythm. That's all the sprint training and weightlifting that did. USRPT did. USRPT is terrible for breaststroke, quite frankly. Yeah.
You think it would be the best for breaststroke because breaststrokers tend to be a little weird, right? They don't train this. They typically don't train the same. They train a little bit more like sprinters typically. And they don't, you know, you don't want those knees to be torqued for very long, but I go 400s with age groupers that can handle it, you know, for time. And we look at that as compared to their two and their one. And we see dramatic improvements because they're going slow enough to be able to feel that rhythm and yet not so slow that they're completely off. I think there are people that argue that you have to go full speed in order to have a good stroke. And I think the opposite is probably true. Or they're both true. You can have great strokes for distance. And people say it's garbage yardage, haven't watched Greg Troy work out or Ron Aiken.
I love Greg Troy's workouts, you know, and he's pushing like high volumes, was pushing with Ryan Lochte and Caleb Dressel. And that's why Ryan Lochte stayed so long in sport. I remember back in 2000, probably 2004 or so, I showed to Greg Troy Ryan's relative endurance ratio between times. I thought, if Ryan wants to swim good 200, he needs to improve some speed work, you know, increase some power because his ratio is too low. So he's more like 400 and even longer distance right now. And Greg was very smart and he thought, yes, I can do that, but that will make him stay shorter in sport. If I'll keep him as long as possible on good endurance base level, he'll be staying long time in sport. And that's exactly true. I was very impressed with Greg, like frankly.
The other thing Greg did was phenomenal is Michael Phelps, when Michael Phelps was dominating and his swimmers were just coming, his swimmer was just coming up. He was getting beat all the time underwater. Michael had worked the underwaters really, really well. I always tell people, I don't know if this is true, I have to interview Bob, but what I imagine is he said, look, because he had to make deals, right? And so he would say, if you go dolphin kick to 15 meters, I'll let you breathe every stroke and fly. I almost think that's the deal they made, you know? But what he was so good underwater, and then Lochte passed him. So, you know, but you know, Greg, that was no accident. It was like Titmus beating Ledecky. It was on purpose. You know, they went after him, beating him underwater. So I don't know if you had something to do with that, but you could just see that you could look at previous races and then pretty soon Lochte starts beating him underwater. And that couldn't have been easy to develop. And I don't think you can get somebody on the 400 IM or the 200 IM to dolphin kick like crazy off that last 50 meters free. And still be going not 15, but pretty close to 15 meters, unless you train them with some really good aerobic base. Don't you think that's pretty much impossible?
I mean, the aerobic base is everything. You cannot cover, you cannot do a lot of anaerobic training, as I mentioned at the beginning of our talk, without good aerobic training, because you will not be recovering. You do one set and then you need 2 days rest, okay? So as well, really aerobically fit, they can do in practice 2 sets, okay? They can do every day because their recovery is faster. And also younger swimmers are recovering faster. That's why training is so interesting. You know, you can benefit so much changing just training, recovery intervals, sets, weekly training design, daily training design, seasonal training design, long-term training design. And as I told, all this stuff is developed by us in different software in the Talent ID database, as well as in the eCoach software. And we are probably much more ahead using scientific principles and scientific research developing this software. We're not developing software based on somebody's experience. We're developing software on the scientific data that we have. That's a completely different approach.
Do you have access to more than, not to say 1,000 isn't a large N, but what if we had access to all of the data of all the swimmers who swim in American swimming? Wouldn't that give us at least some chance of being even more accurate and being able to identify the coaches and the programs that are improving the most, and then go to them and see if they're exactly in line with the principles that you're saying, and then have a broader impact amongst coaches and parents or boards or whatever that are hiring coaches that are more scientific and better at this sort of thing? I just think I'm just so frustrated at the amount of talent that's probably going to waste.
Oh, absolutely. I told you, assuming that long time ago, back in 2005, I suggested the project Talent ID. That's what I developed myself now. Yes, assuming we had multiple meetings with coaches, smart coaches, good friends of mine. But at the same time, they decided that that's not worth for them to do. Okay. They wanna better do themselves small things that they're doing, and nobody share this information. Okay. You wanna share all this information. That's how sport in the country is developed.
That's how we get
store this information. Let's say you're investing money, US assuming invests money, US Olympic Committee invests money in athletes. Okay, what return? Medal, it's good, but can we get more return? Can we know what did you train at age 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and so on to become this level? Why we don't have this information? Because nobody creates the system how to collect this information. And that's what we created now, Talent ID database. And I offered to US Assuming, club development division at that time, Pat Hagen was leading, and Tom Avicius and other guys, great people, you know. But for some reason, they decided, oh, no, that's too complicated. We don't need that, you know. We just train, you know.
We just got to the same. We're winning because of our numbers. And we continue to win because of our numbers. But
we could be so much better. I'll tell you. As I told, world record 100 freestyle should be 43.9 if you swim just by mechanically better right now, not 46.9.
Would you be willing to, I have a lot of the underwater video from, and I'm sure you have probably more than I have, is that you and I could maybe share mechanically and as well the next time we talk, that we could maybe share what we see?
Yeah, we could do that. I probably would not be able to share elite level swimmers because they don't want me to share their videos. The velocity curve, everything, you know, those 80 plus Olympic champions that we have already on file. In fact, seven of them won gold medals in the Tokyo Olympic Games that they worked directly with. Yeah.
So they won't let you show the velocity on that or the.
No, they just don't want to share their technique, you know, with the rest of the world. I understand that's a competition, you know.
What if I do it? I mean, I've got some of the stuff that's on YouTube, right? We can show the underwater videos that are on YouTube because that's legal. Anything on YouTube.
I mean, underwater videos is not a problem, but the elastic curve with underwater video, that's a different story.
Yeah, we don't have to lay that over, but I think I could do that too. Because it's pretty easy to do. You know their velocity, you know where they started, and you know what the time is, and you pretty much know what the curve is. Yeah. But I think Finis actually has a new product that maybe does that, but I don't know. But yeah, forget about the curve for a minute. Just we'll be able to tell by the split or just by what we see and happening to the hands and the pitch. And I don't know. I think it'd be a great conversation. People would be really interested to see you and I have.
Yeah, I'm happy probably to do that. We just need to pick up right time because as I thought, unfortunately, I have to go to the airport soon today. Because I'm traveling so much, it's just my travel schedule is just crazy. Yeah, we just need to find right time for that. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll email you to find out the next time. And it's been awesome. Thank you so much. I think it's going to be very good for people.
Nice to meet you. I'm surprised that we didn't meet before. Maybe we met somewhere at the competitions, you know.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't remember it that well either, but I hear more about you. So now it's great to just to know and how far ahead you are from almost anybody. It's just awesome to catch up and to know a lot more about you and about what you do. What you do is the future. There's no doubt. It should be what's happening. And almost every team that wants to be good ought to be doing what you're doing. And you could be wrong. I mean, let's just say it out there as a scientist, maybe everybody should be swimming 25s and 12 and a halfs. But, and you know, there's some, Mike and Davis Pesalo especially would say, well, I proved it, you know, over the course of years, look how many swimmers I had that were really good that trained only this way. Maybe we're wrong, but we're open for that. And as long as they can prove it, that's what I'm saying. A large database often tells the truth. One talented swimmer, Bill Sweeten, and I have had the last couple, I don't know if you've seen our interviews.
Yeah, I've seen not entire interview, but I've seen this.
Yeah, it's too long and I'm talking too much, as you can tell. But he said, you know, a lot of times it's you get this one great swimmer and they're having you speak and they're having you give anecdotes on what you did in workout. And really, they should be patting God on the back. Because
absolutely.
Cause, yeah.
You're killing 95 swimmers and you're developing 5 good swimmers, you know. I don't know if that's a good result for the coach, you know. Yeah. developing one swimmer out of 200, you know, and really super swimmer. Is that a good result of coach work? I think you should develop like most of swimmers to their potential, what they can reach. That's probably a good result.
And then, as you said, if they were supposed to go a 43 and they went a 46, I mean, you can't prove that until they do it, right? But if they were, then you kind of raise your eyes, and I'm completely with you. The person going 40, I see people pulling with the top hand first, and we'll talk about that, pulling with the top hand first. And I'm like, wow. And some really smart people have said, pull with the top hand first. And somebody has to convince me why that works. And that's another thing we can talk about the next time, where the individual stroke of the individual swimmer,
yes,
may be the best for them, but it may not too. Sometimes you have to take a stand as a scientist and as a coach and say, look, you want to be better? You gotta develop this, right? Hey, have a great trip to Atlanta, and hopefully next week or the week after. Do you think you might be available sometime in the next?
Yeah, I'll be back in the staying in the country until probably mid of the month or so. So we can schedule probably something
awesome
next week or following week. Okay.
Well, I hope we get to meet in person real soon too. You're living in Colorado?
Correct, Colorado Springs. Yeah.
Okay. Well, great. Maybe I'll have an excuse to go up there.
Absolutely.
And you're always welcome here in Southern California. You know, it's pretty warm here.
Okay, thank you. I'm coming actually to Southern California frequently, work with different teams.
Oh, that's right. Maybe I'll catch up with you there when you come to see Mark or something. Okay.
Yes.
Awesome.
Okay. Thank
Have
you.
Have a good day.
Have a nice day. You too.
Thanks again.